Oh, I see. Well, you go. I'll give it to you later.
Actually, I have the wrong glasses. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Frontline Club. Thank you for coming tonight. In just a moment, I'll hand you over to Matt Frei, who is currently Europe editor at Channel 4 News. But more importantly for tonight, he was until quite recently based in Washington. Before I do that, if I can just ask you to switch your phones to silent. And when it comes to questions, if you can wait for the microphone, because we are broadcasting live. So over to Matt.
Thank you very much. Thanks for turning up. It's nice and cozy and warm in here, which we all appreciate, especially when there's so many of you. And let me first of all introduce you to my esteemed panel. We'll start off on our right with Rob Carolina. Is it Carolina?
Carolina.
North or south?
Both.
Both. Okay. Okay. Rob Carolina. He is. Well, describe what you do.
I'm the chair of Democrats Abroad, United Kingdom. We're the official overseas arm of the Democratic Party.
Okay. All right. So you're a true believer in the Obama cause.
Absolutely.
Fantastic. Okay. Then we have Xenia Wickett, formerly the State Department. And I think at one stage you worked for the vice president in 2001. That would have been Dick Cheney.
Yes, it would have been.
Dick Cheney. You worked for Dick Cheney.
Do you want to say that again? Yes, I
you
worked for Dick Cheney.
For Dick Cheney, exactly.
I also worked for President Bush.
You did. Oh, fantastic. Okay. And what was that like? Working for Dick Cheney. Fascinating.
He's an incredibly smart guy.
Dick Cheney.
I disagree with him on most everything, but he's an incredibly smart guy.
And very funny, actually. I met him once, and he was very funny. He had a very dry sense of humour. And
funny.
Then he scared me a lot.
Donald Rumsfeld's funny.
Donald Rumsfeld.
Which is a little scary as
okay.
well, but that's...
You see, the audience all want to know about Donald Rumsfeld's stand-up comedy. Later. Anyway, Xenia works for Chatham House. She is your head of their Americas project, is that
yep.
right? Okay, so an expert. Then, to my left, we have the esteemed Kim Gattas. Who is when I worked for the BBC, she was my colleague, my friend. She is still my friend, but we worked very close together in the Washington Bureau. And now Kim is very interesting because Kim competed with someone called Hillary Clinton for air miles. And you know what? It was almost a tie. Because wherever Hillary went, Kim went as well. And then Kim wrote a very good book about it called The Secretary.
Yeah, I competed with her as well, see who could get the book out first.
Ah, indeed, yes. And who won
I
that
made
one?
It.
You made it, exactly. Anyway, it is a much better book than her subject's book, I have to say. And so Kim Gattas, now, what do you do now? You're still in Washington, right?
Yes, I still cover foreign policy.
You do?
And I'll be keeping
but you're no
an eye
longer
on...
tied to the State Department. You don't
no.
have to travel with John Kerry.
Not anymore.
Which is a blessing, maybe. Maybe not.
Well, I was tired of all the traveling and the jet lag.
Do they give you an air miles card when you travel with...
No.
No, they don't,
no,
do they?
No, they don't.
That's a pity.
No.
That's really a pity, actually, because you'd be first class for the rest
oh,
of your life.
Oh, it's the privilege.
Okay.
It's the privilege.
Anyway, Kim knows Washington politics and foreign policy inside out. And then last but by no means least, we have Michael Goldfarb, who is a veteran, correspondent, writer, broadcaster, a reader of the runes, a dissector of the entrails of American politics, and crucially, the American soul, like few others. Michael, I haven't mentioned about you.
Well, you didn't mention both my books and who published
them. Well, I don't do that. You can mention your book.
Okay.
I don't do
it's
books.
It's very kind of you.
Apart from Kim's.
Very kind of you. Yes, and the sender of occasional tweets to those whose runes have been read incorrectly.
Ah, right. Okay. Excellent. So we have four individuals with strong opinions and lots of insight. And now I want to... This is what... So when you apply for a BBC job, as Kim and I have done on many occasions, there's a sort of moment in the interview when they say, okay, imagine that the following person needs to have their legacy broadcast right now on air. You have literally a few seconds to think about this. And let's imagine the following scenario, that President Barack Obama has done what he's always really wanted to do, which is to play golf full time. Okay, so he has already signed up to the golf course full time membership in Honolulu. He's off, and we now have to write his legacy. And it's got to be a minute and a half long, not too long, so that we can perhaps keep that on a shelf for a later day when he's no longer playing golf. So I think ladies first. Xenia.
The joys. Okay. President, well, I mean, clearly his legacy, if he's gone off to play golf and retired, is going to be the fact that he was the president that went off and played golf. But putting that aside, I would say if we're looking out 10 years from now, his legacy is going to be economic. You know, President Obama came in 2009 after the financial... recession, the great recession in 2008, And if you listen to his State of the Union yesterday, America is strong. If we're looking 10 years from now, I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt, although frankly I think this is perhaps a little over-optimistic. In addition to the economy, it's also trade. We could see him move forward an agenda on either TTIP, the trade agreement with Europe, or TPP, the trade agreement, very, very high on his priority list. That's going to be one. Number two is going to be, and this is not actually in any particular order, environment. I think if he hasn't been able to do it through bills, he's done it through executive order. The movement that America has taken over the last 5 years, 6 years on the environment has been quite significant. Then I think it's got to be immigration. There's got to be a legacy on immigration. You can't go back.
Right.
Healthcare, clearly, most of it's domestic. Obamacare, whether you like it or not. And then again, I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt as my final legacy is Cuba, yes, but Iran.
Ah, okay, so that's quite a laundry list. You've got five big items there.
Yes.
You've slightly run over time, but we'll forgive you. Kim.
I'm not going to go into details. I'm going to paint a broad picture. I'm going to describe him as the president who always struggled to convince people in the US and abroad that he was a good president, that he did a good job, because the narrative of him being a reluctant president stuck no matter what he achieved internally. And that is because on the world stage, he was seen as somebody who always wanted to avoid doing certain things. He wanted to avoid going further into Afghanistan. He wanted to get out of Iraq. He wanted to limit his engagement when it comes to ISIS in the Middle East. And so I think the narrative of this reluctant man has stuck, and I think he gets criticized a lot. There's a lot of Obama bashing going on because either you're on the right or you're on the left and he's disappointed you on some level. But I think that down the road, people will realize that actually he did achieve quite a lot and he's not getting enough credit for it.
Okay. Michael.
Well, let's say he decides to postpone the golf game till 2016. And I would say that he was a president who had the misfortune to be in government and leading government at a time of unprecedented partisanship, unprecedented since the decade before the American Civil War, and found it very hard going, and he didn't quite have the personality to rise above it. But he was also a president at a time when no one was really in charge, that the world was in a terrible state of drift. It's always been that at moments like this, the United States leadership will prevent drifting too far, and it was just not possible. And so 2 years from now, I'm going to say that Syria will still be unsolved. And I think people will look back and say, you know, there was a moment in the first 6 months of that unraveling when he could have gone all in, but it would have meant putting troops in the region at a moment when he's trying to get them out. And that will hang heavy on him because the fallout from Syria, I think, will continue to disturb Europe, the Middle East, and because it's become the battleground for the civil war going on in Islam, and that will not be played out for a long time yet. That will hang over him. I'm enthused about Obama, but I doubt some of the economic good news. I don't think it's spread evenly enough around the American system. And I think the immediate obit would be there was a lot more to be done underneath the headlines. So there.
Okay. Rob.
Well, as the only member of this esteemed panel who's not a journalist, I hope I get a pass for whatever awful thing I say next. I think with the passage of some time, if we were to do a retrospective in, say, 20 or 30 years' time, I think that the president will be remembered as, and his administration will be remembered as, a time when America went through a generational shift and went through a significant change in how we think about ourselves as Americans and as a society. And part of that has to do with changes in society that that have happened that he might not have caused directly, but he is certainly part of that change. We see changes to approaches in civil rights in the US, the emergence of LGBT rights as a main issue. The first major breakthrough in the delivery of health care to Americans in more than half a century. The idea that we should be focusing again on our major pieces of infrastructure, the idea that we should again tend to a social safety net, in a way is sort of a major shift in how we view ourselves as a society that we haven't really seen since a changing election, perhaps as FDR or possibly Ronald Reagan.
Right. Okay, well, that's all very interesting. I agree with most of it, I think. What I find fascinating personally about Obama is that he came to office, and none of you mentioned the glaringly obvious fact that he was the first African.
Okay.
I mean, it's just a minor little detail, but let's put that in there as well, because I think
that is the.
But I was going to say, he came to office with this amazing, you know, partly self-generated, but also generated by everyone else, baggage of hope and change and all the rest of it, and in a precipitous way. I mean, you say he was the reluctant leader. He was not the reluctant candidate. I mean, he went for it, hell for leather. And then, ever since being in office, he's become, in my book anyway, to embody the limitations of the office and of America. Would you agree with that?
I agree that he embodies that to some extent, but I think some of those limitations are also because of his own personality and his own perceptions of American power. And I say that because, you know, I traveled for 4 years with somebody like Hillary Clinton. Yeah. And whatever you think of her politics or her vision for American foreign policy, I think that where the two diverge, Obama and Clinton, is that Clinton has a visceral belief in the need for American leadership on the international stage.
And why is
in
that?
In a way that he doesn't, he doesn't quite have that. It's not, I mean, he has a different perception. I see, Zinya, you're shaking your head.
I tell you, you can disagree in a minute. I just want to ask you one quick question. Do you think that's because she spent time in the White House as the First Lady, and therefore she was used to the whole, the theater of power, and, you know, that was part of her kind of DNA more than it was for Barack Obama, or is it because he was an outsider?
No, I think it's because she's a more forward-leaning, let's say, on the use of American power, including military.
Okay.
But I just... Because I think I know what you're going to say, but I just want to add one thing. I think that President Obama does have great vision for American leadership, and I think that he's thinking long-term about how to position on the international stage by doing things like trying to strike a deal with Iran, which would help reduce America's military footprint in the Middle East, mm-hmm. and combined with energy independence that the U.S. is achieving, you know, it changes a lot for the U.S. in a positive way. But it's just about the perception that he gives of what he thinks is American power.
You were shaking your head, now you're nodding. This is alarming. You're beginning to agree with
I'm convinced.
Him.
We can't.
No. So what I agree with is a difference in perception. Mm-hmm. What I would characterize it is, and I don't think this will be part of his, I don't think this will be in the write-up of his legacy, but I think what we tend to forget is the transformation of the environment in which America sits today over the last, say, decade or 15, 20 years. So the nature of the challenges we face today, I mean, just list them. You know, you've got pandemics, you know, Ebola, you've got terrorism, you've got environmental degradation, you've got energy limitations that are beginning to hit us potentially, you've got food limitations, that, you know, all of these, they don't care about borders. They are global in nature. They cannot
but
be dealt
with. But we've
always
had some of these problems.
We've always had, but not as tangibly as we do today. Not as tangibly as we do today. And so the nature of the challenges in which we face, whereas 40 years ago, America believed, the world believed, and to some extent it was true, that America could deal with it alone. Or could lead vastly in front. Now, I'm exaggerating for effect, but nevertheless, the case remains that the environment has changed. Obama has been put into that environment. That requires a different type of leadership. Now, do I think that Obama has done a strategic vision about, oh, we need a new kind of leadership, and this is the environment, and therefore we're going to look like this? No, I don't. But I do think it requires something fundamentally different.
Okay. Michael.
Well, I don't fundamentally disagree, except perhaps we could make it a bit more specific and get with causality. I mean, it's interesting because you asked Matt, where Hillary Clinton comes by this. And what I find interesting in the Obama administration is that at one point he had Hillary Clinton as Secretary of State, and he had Samantha Power working in a variety of roles in the National Security Council, and now she's the ambassador to the UN. And both of them, I think, share a view that was formed in the first term of Bill Clinton's presidency when the Bosnian War was going on. And the lesson that I think Hillary Clinton probably absorbed was, in the end, American leadership is necessary to stop this kind of conflict. And of course, Samantha, you know, what I knew in Sarajevo, absorbed all the lessons about her interventionist inclinations, covering that terrible tragedy from Sarajevo. And it's interesting that when the Arab Spring erupted, we're told, I mean, the narrative is, that Obama was reluctant. Kim can tell me whether that's true or not. But it was the women around him. It was the Secretary of State. It was Samantha Power saying, no. You have to tell Mubarak it's time. And when it spread to Libya, you have to back the insurgents against Gaddafi. And even if it, and he said, well, I'm not going to send troops. So they came up with the plan that was.
So what are you saying? Are you saying the women around him have more cojones than he does, or that he likes being surrounded by strong women?
No, I think that he's reluctant, and the reason he's reluctant is, if you came to power as he did, with the global economy in tatters around your ankles, two failed wars, with hundreds of thousands of American soldiers being blown up, you know, in life-threatening situations, you are likely to say, you know what, time out, and it's time to withdraw where we can.
Yeah.
And so that is may have informed his view as well. And the women prodded him to say, well, it can't be done permanently.
Can I just, very quick.
On the Mubarak, Obama was for and Clinton was against pushing him out.
I want to ask you, hang on a second, Rob, I'm going to ask you a personal question. No, you can't. So you have, unlike all the other three esteemed members of the panel, you have a skin in this fight. Because you actually, you know, you're not a bundler, are you? No. I'd love to know you think you're a bundler. Bundlers are people who collect lots of money for Obama. But you represent his interests abroad, you know, the interests of Obama, the Democratic Party. So you, presumably you campaigned for him in 2008, right?
Yep.
You were very hopeful for him. Mm-hmm. Were you disappointed at any stage in the last 7 years?
You know, a good friend of mine I talked to in 2008, just after the election, when I was in Chicago on business, said to me, well, now that Obama has won the election, the only people he's likely to disappoint are the people who are his supporters. I mean, that's almost inevitable in a situation like that, because he didn't disappoint the Republicans. If anything, they seem to glory in whatever they think is
but
wrong.
But did he disappoint you?
There, like anyone who supported Obama, there are things that I wish he could have done more of, that I wish he could have gone farther with. And I want to echo something that Michael just said that picks up on this, and that's the environment in which he found himself. Whatever the president's legacy is going to be, I suspect that it will mostly be remembered around domestic issues and not international. And I think that's in part because people who are remembered for the American presidents who are remembered on the international stage are very often remembered for having started a war. And unfortunately, there's no sort of department of legacy for presidents who manage not to start wars or who manage to end wars or exit wars at some sort of a graceful fashion. There have been any number of times in the last 6 years when people have been railing and screaming and jumping up and down and saying, you know, send more troops here, send bombs there, put boots on the ground in this place, that place, the other place. And unfortunately, you know, that probably will not be on the top two or three or four paragraphs of anyone who remembers this administration, which is a shame because I think it's actually one of his strongest accomplishments.
And yet, of course, and you know, and much of the world and even much of America was exasperated by the exuberance of George W. Bush and the excessive use of American power.
I think his legacy is pretty clear.
Exactly. But so is Obama's. His legacy is a legacy. Obama's legacy is a legacy of negatives, if you like, absences, the absence of a war that he started, and the absence of an economic calamity. I mean, preventing economic calamity is more difficult. They're more difficult to get brownie points for that than actually causing great economic success.
The depression that didn't happen isn't as big a news story as the depression that did. And in his case, you know, he's managed to, I mean, sort of coming back from the brink of economic collapse was by no means simple.
Yeah.
It was by no means assured. And there were many people, for example, who were saying that, oh, the automobile industry, oh, it's far past its best by date. It's far best its used by date. Don't try to recover that. And the fact that he exercised, brought that industry back and saved how many, you know, countless jobs in the United States is an incredibly important and positive. So it's not just the absence of the negative. There are also a number of positives that he can and should be remembered for.
And one of the positives is definitely the economy. And I think, you know, that, yes, you know, there is still inequality, etc. You know, not everybody is feeling the impact. But the president's approval ratings have just hit 50%.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
I mean, that's quite something. It's a big jump over the last few months.
Yeah.
And
is it, why is that, do you think? Why is that?
Feel the sort of the trickle down effect of the improving.
Is it because he's basically now finally thumbed his nose at the Republicans?
No,
there's no point
yeah,
in, you know, they've taken over the House and the Senate. What the hell? Might as well go for it.
No, you know? For the first time, Americans say that they feel good, that they feel
the future of America.
The future of America is good or excellent. And, you know, more
that's
so
a big
than,
turnaround,
than,
yeah.
than any, yeah. at any point in the last sort of decade. And I think that is a great turnaround. And that is something that will also benefit, you know, the potential next candidate of the Democratic Party, whoever that is. But I want to disagree with Rob on the point of, you know, he will not be remembered for ending wars. Well, that's because there is another war going on, which he very reluctantly entered, and it's a war against a non-state actor. It's the war against Daesh or ISIS or ISIL, whatever you want to call them. And as Michael pointed out, there are those, including the president of France, François Hollande, who said, well, you know, if we had done something a little bit more forceful back in 2012, perhaps we wouldn't be here.
In Syria.
Yeah. And I'm not saying necessarily boots on the ground. And it's easy, I know, to say, if only you had done that, we wouldn't be here. But there is, you know, there is something about vacuum. There is something about, you know, the lack of this unwillingness to shape events sometimes by this president, because he thinks it's a faraway problem. It's not, it doesn't have a direct impact on American national security until it does.
Isn't the fact that every presidency is a reaction to the previous presidency, you know, that actually Obama is more non-Bush than Obama, and, you know, Bush was non-Clinton and so on, and that's just the way, that's the way that cookie crumbles.
Yeah,
that they have their own vision of how to do things
ground.
But they're so keen not to imitate the mistakes of their predecessors.
Except for free trade and making sure there's no re-regulation of Wall Street and its twin, the city.
Yeah.
That has no party behind it. And that is the driver of the, you know, today, yes, the job numbers here, the job numbers in America are improving. But then we know the statistics are compiled differently. And a 1 hour a week job here is considered you're re-employed, and there are similar fudges of statistics there. So there is a reaction. I mean, you run against the previous president, you're running against the opposite party.
But you govern against the previous party as well.
You know, but then you have other realities, which is when you have a Congress that is, in America, I grew up, there was none of this British-style whipping where, you know, if you were a Republican from Maine, you could vote with the Democrats because it represented your
That's
voters.
That's different, isn't it?
That
has really changed.
Different now. And it's come to a terrible fruition in these last 6 years and won't change over the next
Okay, let me ask you all a question then. Do you think that the American system, which was set up under more gentlemanly rules, is simply not capable of dealing with this kind of partisan division, that it just breaks apart?
No. I mean, it is far too easy to talk about America's system being broken. You know, America's system was created quite intentionally with checks and balances.
But if it's trench warfare, that's not checks and balances anymore.
Well, except that, wait a sec, okay, so we get concerned that, and we're right to get concerned, that America isn't achieving everything that we would like it to do. It isn't dealing with economic growth and inequality and immigration and you know, rights, et cetera, as well as effectively as we would want it to. On the other hand, back in September of last year, when President Obama wanted to start training Syrian opposition, he took it to Congress. Congress took no time at all to come up with a bipartisan agreement to do it. If America really wants to move forward, it's quite capable of moving forward. Mm. Is it dysfunctional? absolutely. But I actually want to go to a point Kim said, which is perceptions and perceptions versus reality. Because I think this is where Obama really has it hard, perhaps. The perception of Obama and the Obama presidency has been all about reluctance, has been all about what wasn't done. The reality of the Obama presidency is quite different, whether it's on immigration and I do think we have to recognize that there's a disjunct between reality and perception. And he will always, I think, be me kind of marked down, if you will.
And how do you explain that? So he's so legislation doesn't lie. It's on the books. It's working its way through. And there's, you know, as you rightly said, he's clocked up a lot of victories there. Why is he not being given the credit for that? I'm not just talking about Republicans. I'm talking about self-doubting, self-hating Democrats. You know.
And I think this is where I do agree with Kim. Absolutely.
The point
he made
at the beginning.
Yeah. I mean, it's his style. It's his persona. It's the way he does things. I mean, I find it ironic that I remember when he first became president, and we were, he would say, you know, he wanted to move a bill forward, and he'd say, I want to move this forward, I have this objective, I'm going to send it to Congress to come up with the solution. And he did that because Congress kept saying, you know, you never ask us, you never want our opinion, you're forcing things through. So he said, Congress, you come up with it. Congress never did anything.
Yeah.
So you can't actually win. Obama can't win, neither can the American government win. We're always going to want it to do more and do less at the same time.
I think what we have is the malfunction that we see in Washington. I wouldn't describe it as systemic. I think it's very concentrated on Congress as an institution. And Congress as an institution, I believe, is malfunctioning significantly because of changes to the Republican Party in the last 20 years.
Yeah.
They have become a party whose philosophy is almost nihilistic in approach, which is not just we want less government, we want almost no government. So a failure to achieve anything is almost a victory. So long as that's the mindset, it continues to be very difficult to get things done. Ultimately, I think the solution for that is a solution that the Republican Party has gotten through before, which is will ultimately need to be a change in who's influencing the Republican Party.
Yeah.
I mean, in more than 50 years ago, the Goldwater people were slightly moved out of the center of that.
We'll get on to that in a minute. Now, I want to throw the questions open to the audience, but before we do that, we're going to warm you up with I'm going to ask you a question. I want a show of hands. Madeleine Albright, I think it was, who came up with the phrase, America being the indispensable power. Who here still thinks that America is an indispensable power? Hands up.
Wow, that's...
that's pretty indispensable. Okay, now...
After the Paris March, right, everybody asked, where was Obama?
Yeah, of course.
You know what nobody asked?
Yeah.
Where was Xi Jinping?
Yeah.
So... You know, in
perhaps it's because Xi Jinping is not normally seen as a kind of beacon
of
liberté, égalité, et fraternité.
Neither are the Egyptians, nor the Russians,
or the president of Mali. Yes.
Who are all?
Okay.
Who are all.
All right. Right. Question from the audience, gentlemen.
Don't you think? Obama is in the most marvelous position. He's the president without any power. And
okay,
in fact,
good
ever
question.
Since he's got into that position, his popularity has improved.
Right. Well, that's exactly the point that Kim was making.
So he's worrying about what happens.
What the gentleman was asking is, don't you think that President Obama is in the most marvelous position for being a president without any power at all? And ever since the midterm elections, his ratings have improved.
The funny thing is that we were talking about this before we started the panel. I was talking about the State of the Union address last night, and I was saying to Matt, I feel like I've got my candidate back. Because the State of the Union address last night very much sounded like the Barack Obama I heard doing his barnstorming speeches in 2007 and 2008. Somehow, when he moved into the White House, he seemed to shift direction and shift his methodology into something a bit more cerebral, a bit more technocratic, a bit more focused. In some ways, the Republican majority in both houses of Congress, I think, has liberated him from that, and now he's back into sort of big picture mode. And he's talking about let's construct a vision for the next 15 years. Let's aspire to something more than we are.
Can he achieve any of that vision when he's a lame duck?
It's possible for the president to do a heck of a lot. I mean, we saw him doing a lot just in the weeks after the election with executive authority. Because the executive branch of the U.S. government, and we always have to talk to people here that how different it is different from a parliamentary system. It's its own branch of government. It has its own authority under the Constitution. And I think we're going to see the president use every ounce of that authority to accomplish whatever part of his agenda he can and to try to set the agenda both for his the remainder of his presidency and the presidency to come.
And set the agenda also in a way of, you know, putting ideas out there that Congress may not act on, but that states...
Setting the narrative.
Yeah, but also that states then act on, like waging the minimum, raising the minimum wage. Yeah. You know, Congress isn't going to do anything about it, but some states are starting to act on that.
Next question. My God, okay, yes. Wait for the mic, please, yeah.
I'm going to go back to the first question that was posed to the panel that you said in 1.5 minutes. So I'm going to ask this very quickly. It was curious to me that we're talking about Obama, who was the first black president of the United States, and will that not leave a major mark in terms of a legacy of everyone in this room? Did we ever think that we would be able to elect a black American? And what has he done in a significant way that has gotten the press's attention and really fired them up in terms of civil rights?
Okay, good question. Right, so the first black president, the black community, according to the opinion polls, is still very much behind him, even though the reality is that they're doing, you know, worse than anyone else.
This is potentially controversial. I think the greatest achievement in that respect is the fact that you have four people here who in various respects follow American political system, and it isn't what we put on as his legacy.
Yeah.
I mean, that, I think, in terms of a statement about where America is today, I think that's a huge statement. In terms of rights, you know, I mean, Rob talked about it, you know, gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender rights, on a number of areas, Gitmo on the one side, oops, hasn't quite closed that, but then, you know, there's all sorts of external reasons for that. In terms of other rights within the United States, immigration, et cetera, I think he's done enormous things.
But, you know, there are still a lot of racial issues
in the
U.S.
And there's much more to do.
I think that the only people who
let me ask
who
it like this.
Say, who will say that, you know, this the fact that we are not mentioning that he's a black president says something, will say, well, the only people who talk about America as a post-racial society are white. They're not black.
Michael.
Well, I think that when historians start looking back, they will look at the very, very unique circumstances that opened up. I mean, like Seabiscuit coming in on the. You had the candidate presumptive, and she acted like it, and perhaps her organization was too lacking in the nimbleness that a good candidate should have a year and a half out from an election. And he went for it, and that is a courageous act. However, having said that, this is the one and only time, because of the disastrous wars that America was in, and all of that, it opened up room. I think that one of the things, and again, this is for historians, and or possibly for him when he sits down and takes a break from playing golf and writes his memoirs, which we can look forward to. We know they'll be well written.
Yeah, true.
Did he decide, as many successful African Americans do, I'm not going to make a thing about my race. You know, I got here, I worked, I'm here. I want to be. You know, I'm not going to play that card. And then suddenly we have this extraordinary explosion of, you know, the police have not been reined back. There's been no bully pulpit use by the president from 2008. And in the last year and a half, we see what the fruition of that is that if you don't tell the police, look, there are limits, you can't keep profiling people, sooner or later, black people are going to get murdered on the streets of America. Now, he could have, I think he was stuck. He couldn't say, you know, look, race is not done with just because I'm president. But he chose to downplay it. And of course, there's a lot more to being president than being a racially profiled president.
Although there are nuances within it, aren't there? Because when Trayvon Martin was shot in Florida, he famously got up, you know, and said, this could have been my son. And he was clobbered for it by the other side and said, you're turning this into a racial debate and so on. So I think the race issue is one that you just can't win on easily, whether you're actually, I mean, as a white president, you don't actually go there. As a black president, if you are pulled there or you tentatively go there, it's going to be really, really tricky. So let me ask the question like this. through no fault of his own, has the sheer presence of a black man in the White House, or a white black man in the White House, made the black issue much more serious than it was before? Has it made America more racist through some weird, toxic chemical reaction?
Everyone's looking at me, oh dear. The fact of the matter is that, I mean, you know, none of us talked about this as a legacy issue. I think we all have to acknowledge the reality that when teenagers in high schools are asked to write about Barack Obama 10 years from now, they'll probably lead with first black president. 50 years from now, that might not be the first sentence. 100 years from now, it might be a footnote, is what I hope will happen. I don't think we can delude ourselves into believing that America has entered a completely post-race issue age. I think that's, you have blinders on if you believe that's happened. The ironic thing, though, is that the one person who least wanted to campaign on and probably least wants to be remembered as, you know, for this legacy is Barack Obama himself. Mm. I mean, remember in the 2008 campaign when he was essentially forced to come and give a speech on race when he had assiduously avoided the topic because he didn't want to be the sort of the I'm about race candidate.
Yeah, okay. Question in the back.
Two questions, sort of.
Hi, Kim. No, you're allowed one question.
Well, one specifically for Kim, one for everyone else.
Okay.
One, Kim, do you think that Clinton will run? And for everyone else, what will be the dominant issue for whoever the candidates are in 2016?
Okay.
I have my money on 80% yes, she runs. 20% still to be decided. Announcement to come sometime in the spring.
Where's the 20%?
The 20% is, is she ready to gear up for the relentlessness of a campaign that could get very ugly? Does she want to go through it all again? What landscape look like? I think it's looking better today with the improving economy than it did even 4 or 5 months ago when it wasn't clear how people felt about it. She's going to make a very pragmatic decision, but she's also going to listen to her gut. She's going to look at the democratic infrastructure on the ground. She's going to look at who are the potential opponents in the Republican Party. Jeb Bush would be a formidable candidate. At some point, I almost wanted to say, if Jeb Bush runs, she's not running.
You know what? I'm so happy the next election is going to be between a Bush. Because, you know, otherwise my mind would just go, you know, I need those two names. I need them to be there. Otherwise, I'm all a dither.
I'm not saying she's not going to run if he runs, but at some point wondered.
The 20% seemed, there has to be some doubt, otherwise they're crazy. But, I mean, 20% seemed like a lot of doubt to me at this point.
You know, she's doing.
You're obviously a very self-confident person,
doing
Michael.
Her
who else is
I always have at least 20% of doubt. I want to ask a question. Now, we're all amongst friends here.
But you have to answer the second question.
No, he answered, well, of course, yes, the agenda, the policies. Okay, you have 30 seconds.
No,
30 seconds on policies. 30 seconds on policies. What's she going to run on?
The reality is it's still going to be, it's going to be the Middle East, no question, foreign policy isn't a really big thing. It's going to be the economy. It's almost inevitably going to be, you know, Clinton versus Bush and legacies and. But I go back to Clinton, Bill's, it's the economy, stupid. That's what everybody cares about.
Okay.
I'm also with the 80-20, but for slightly different reasons.
Now, okay, as I said, we're all amongst friends.
We're
all amongst friends. We're all amongst friends. So I want to know, and please be honest here, who in this room is a Republican? Thank you, sir. Okay, now, I want to ask you. Then you can stay there. You don't have to come up here. I'm going to ask you, where are you from?
Originally from California.
Okay. I want to ask you, a California Republican in the Frontline Club, this is history. Okay. I want to ask you how scared you are as a Republican, assuming you want a Republican to win, of a Clinton nomination. Or does it make you happy because you think you can beat her?
I think P.G. O'Rourke said recently that he thought that Hillary Clinton might get passed over as being her generation is being passed over and somebody younger might run.
Ah, okay.
I'm not overly happy about a Clinton or a Bush running. I'd prefer to see somebody else.
Any names that you care to share with us?
Well, if we could dig up Dwight Eisenhower, that would be good.
Okay. Okay. Go back. Okay. But okay. Interesting. hang on. Wait. You'll get your turn. So.
20%.
So I would like to forget the 20%. I'm bored of the 20%.
Over drinks.
Okay. When I covered the 2008 campaign, and the thing that I smelt immediately, and it wasn't a particularly unpleasant smell, but it was that the thing that would kill Hillary in an age of rebellion, which is what we're still in, was a sense, a whiff, a smell of entitlement. I'm in it to win it. Right, I'm Hillary Clinton. You know, I know this stuff. I lived in the White House. I know where the curtains are ironed. I know how I know how power works. I know how to manipulate power in the interest of the party and so on. Is entitlement still a problem for her?
No. I say no.
Ooh, why? Because I was about to say exactly the opposite.
I love it. Excellent.
First of all, she lost in 2008, so she knows that nothing is guaranteed. And she lost, I mean, she was blindsided, I think, completely blindsided. And I think her 4 years...
By the fairy tale, as her husband put it, yeah.
It was a good candidate, good president, Obama. But I think the 4 years at the State Department really not changed her, because there is a constant, there is continuity. But I think she learned a lot, she matured, and she's going to be a very different candidate. She knows that it's not owed to her, and she's not even sure at this point that she wants it. There is a different air to her, except that the political scene or the political stage in the U.S. is such that I don't know if she can maintain the self-assured, cool, warm attitude that she had on the road as Secretary of State, when she's in the glare of American media.
Okay, Xenia.
So I get, maybe I misunderstood your question.
My question was, is entitlement, still a problem?
So I don't think, I agree with everything you said, I don't think she feels entitled. Mm. I think the public, the problem that she is going to have to find a way to sell to the public, given that there isn't right now Democratic candidate who comes anywhere close. I mean, the only name we really keep hearing is Elizabeth Warren, but she says she's probably not going to run. She says she's not going to run. I think she's going to have a really tough job convincing the American public that she doesn't feel entitled. It's not that she does, because as you rightly pointed out, she lost. You know, and she's had a very hard slog for the last however long. But it's going to be really hard to sell that, because you know you've got a whole load of Republicans who are saying, you know, she thinks she's entitled, she's the front runner, and they're going to go after her.
Okay. Okay, good. Excellent. Question.
You just talked about the media.
Yeah.
And
wait for the mic.
Do we think that the media, when you talk about Obama's legacy and what Clinton will probably face in an election, people who have a very bizarre association with facts are given huge platforms on American television?
You're talking about my profession like that?
I'm afraid so. And I don't feel the media do their job by slapping these people down and fact-checking them. I think a lot of conspiracies are allowed to perpetuate themselves. And do you think the media is doing a good enough job? Well, do you think the media are doing their job?
That's a good question. But what I think is interesting about the media question, and apropos of Hillary, actually apropos of Obama now, is... it's become as polarized as anything else. So you know, I mean, the president can say whatever he wants now, and Congress will do what it wants. I mean, today, hours after the State of the Union, John Boehner invited Bibi Netanyahu to address a joint session without telling the White House. This is a breach of protocol. Mm. Yeah. And, you know, about Iran. Now, the president, just last night, he said, look, do you mind? Let me just negotiate this thing, and then we'll have the vote on treaty and so on. If it doesn't work, you can have your sanctions thing. And immediately, they're in his face like this. Now, you know how that is spread out into the American public. Fox News is going to take this and run with it as a good thing. Other media is going to take it as a bad thing and be critical about it. And in the middle of the news space, the social networking space, partisans will speak to each other and find new things to fact check. And what's interesting, I think, is that because media is now as polarized as anything else, Obama or Hillary, people will, who are their partisans, will learn about it through media they trust. And people who think they're the devil incarnate will learn about it through Fox News. And I think that the day when the news media was like this referee almost is passing. And there are so many websites now.
But Fox
that
News
do
is watched by 800,000 people in primetime. MSNBC, which is the opposite on the liberal side, is watched by
wouldn't make that equivalence, Matt, because you know when you look at the comment columns, not crazy comment columns in the New York Times, the Fox News people are there and they cannot be convinced by any of the reporting in the New York Times. And I think MSNBC is a bad example.
I agree with you that there's, you know, it's trench warfare in terms of the media, but I'm just wondering how many Americans actually pay attention to that.
Well, I don't know that they pay attention, as I was saying to this guy. I think that now, particularly the younger voters, and by younger, I mean younger than me, you know, anybody under 50, is getting their facts checked through their social networks. Mm. And that's why there's been this enormous proliferation. It wasn't just, you know, Nate spinning off 538 from the New York Times for a lot of money. It's there are people out there, there are well-funded on the Republican side, poorly funded on the Democratic side, you know, groups of little guys, you know, with their political science degrees, fact-checking and pumping stuff out on Twitter. And that's how people are getting informed nowadays on politics in America.
Next question. You're next. You.
None of the panel mentioned drone strikes, the increase in drone strikes. How important do you think it's going to be in the future that there was this big increase in extrajudicial killing by the president? And could that precedent spread to other countries in the future?
The legacy of drones.
So I'm going to kind of... I'm going to expand your question a little bit and actually go back to something that Rob was saying. Rob rightly said that President Obama is going to use executive order whenever he can because he has an agenda. He wants to get that agenda filled. It is clear he's not getting that through the traditional process through Congress. While I may agree with many of President Obama's policies on the environment, on immigration, et cetera, that really scares me. Because, well, all well and good when I agree with what the policies are, but what about if I don't agree with what the policies are? And so you're setting a precedent that other people will then follow. The same is true of drone strikes. There's absolutely no question that drones is a, relatively speaking, new technology, last decade, that has totally transformed the policy options that policy I used to be would have in dealing with problems. They have their place in the arsenal where we need to start worrying is when they are the arsenal. You know, one of the critiques of President Bush was willingness to throw mass forces at a problem. One of the critiques of President Obama is unwillingness to throw mass forces. And where we are, as policymakers, where we are getting it wrong is that we find the newest tool.
So you'd rather see American armies march across the sands of Arabia?
No, I would rather see the diplomatic service funded to something even vaguely close to the military. Mm-hmm. You know, what you need to do is to stop the problems from happening. You know, the military isn't the tool we've all got. But the State Department's budget is something like 1% of the Defense Department's budget. It may actually be something like, I remember numbers, the Defense Department's budget is something like $4 billion. And the State Department's budget is something like 56 million. Mm. I mean,
Congress keeps cutting.
And it keeps cutting. I mean, it's hugely different. We need other tools. Drones are a tool, but they're not the tool.
Agreed.
And drones and this sort of counterterrorism light approach to problems, I think, gives a feeling to policymakers in Washington that they are doing something about the problem. But in effect, it's not solving anything because you're not going to eliminate ISIL or deal with that problem just by you know, sending out, whether they're drones or planes, to carry out 5 or 6 or even 10 airstrikes a day. That is not the answer to the problem in Syria and in the Middle East.
Okay, next question. Gentleman over there.
This is such a very polite, nice panel. I was one before Christmas with Stryker McGuire and Mark Mardell and Bob Wister and people, and they were not so nice on the question of breakage, Xenia. Tory Grandy stood up in the audience and said, is the American system broken? We've got 2 years to go, and the way this meeting was proposed is a disastrous Congress. The 50% that Obama's got as party, because the American public wants the presidency to take control of the situation. I think it's a fight to death between these two parties. Is it possible for him? Mark Mardell said, I asked the same question, if Obama starts really governing, he'll be a dictator. What powers does he have to run the government? And what can the Congress do to him? And, you know, in 2 years from now, are we going to have a government that's completely on its knees?
Okay. So are you saying that what's the actual question?
The question is, can he govern under these conditions?
Right. Okay.
And is, in fact, a fight to the death party conflict between these two parties?
Rob.
I think we have seen the president governing, and we're going to continue to see him govern within the constraints that are given to him by the Constitution. He's still the commander-in-chief of our military. He has executive authority to disperse those troops as he sees fit within the framework of war-making powers, restrictions in the Constitution. We've seen him make use of executive orders and will continue to do so. We'll, I'm sure, see things come out of administrative departments. What is difficult in the current climate is passing legislation. And the fulcrum, you know, the power balance is going to be when it comes budget time, and the argument comes up with the Republicans, are we going to get something through or are we going to have a stalemate? You know, it wasn't too long ago that Newt Gingrich decided that having won a big majority in Congress, that, you know, was trying to stall the budget and shut everything down and play, you know, chicken with the sitting president was a really great idea. That turned out to be a not very good political strategy for the Republican Party at the time. I do believe that one of the ways this thing is going to resolve itself is that, you know, the American people are very, very upset with Congress as an institution. Part of it has to do with a growing level of unease at the way the Tea Party has moved and significantly influenced the workings of the Republican Party, if not individual Republicans. And I'll end with this thought, which I'll go back to our Republican in the audience who said that he might like to bring back Dwight Eisenhower as a candidate. If he did, today he'd be a Democrat. Mm. There's no question about it in my mind. You know, as I've said to people before, this is not my father's Republican Party, because both my parents were Republicans their whole life. And Eisenhower was, in his day, approached by both parties to run for president, and he was the one who elected to serve with the Republicans. He felt a closer affinity to them. If you were to be able to wake him up today and ask him, you know, what looks more like your brand of politics, or what you think government is for, or what you think America is for, or what you think we can accomplish in the world, I feel there's a reasonably good chance he would say, well, the guys standing with this Obama character seem to be the right people.
And also, I think there's very this perception, perhaps, you know, overseas, that, you know, the U.S. is in decline and the system is broken and it's all just crumbling. And perhaps that's a perception that the media feeds. I don't agree necessarily.
Yeah, so, I live overseas.
It's not 100% okay.
Well, when you live in Europe, darling, you don't think decline is such a big deal in America.
I do think there's a lot, there is something, this is... But in my lifetime, historically unprecedented, the degree, the system, you know, when this started, when Newt Gingrich had the contract on America, Congress, were you in Washington by then, Matt, or not?
No.
In 94. You know, the contract on America, and they came to office, and they said, you know, we're going to make Bill Clinton a one-term president. Mm. It wasn't about legislation, it wasn't about a different philosophy about taxes and the economy and welfare, it was about personalizing it and destroying. Jim DeMint, senator from South Carolina who now runs the Heritage Foundation, it told me, I interviewed him during the 2009 when they're trying to get the healthcare bill passed. Yeah, I said that. This will be his Waterloo, and I want him, you know, I'm trying to destroy. He's even said the word destroy, not make him a one-term, destroy. Now, you say, okay, well, that's rhetoric for the campaign trail. But when you take it into your office in the Capitol and you act on it, every single day, then I have to say that there is something broken. And, you know, you can say, well, it's because it's, you know, they're all whores and they're paid for others or whatever. I'm not sure that that's true. I think that the system can only work when there's an understanding that the reason it was devised by, you know, Madison and the other founding fathers is it only works so far as people can be gentlemanly and say, well, we'll agree to disagree with this. We have a government to run and we have to reach some compromise. That's gone. I don't know when it will come back. Because of that, there is an element of the system that is broken, and the way to govern is, I think, I mean, who here even had an inkling, maybe Kim did, that in November he was going to cut the Gordian knot and say, I'm just going to reestablish diplomatic relations with Cuba. That's an astonishing step forward. And I think there are two or three other things you can do with executive orders, did it with immigration, that will say, you know what, this is it. And if you want to fight about it, go ahead, but I can do this and I will.
But it's interesting, actually, in Washington, even when I started there just after 9/11, you still came across congressmen who kind of had the occasional drink together. And of course, it was the post 9/11 spirit, so people were sort of more united than they are now. Now, I bet you will not find a single congressman from either side breaking bread with someone, you know, on the opposite side of the aisle. That's just not done anymore. You know, Reagan famously played golf with Tip O'Neill, you know, every other day. So, you know, that does not exist. And I think that is a fundamental change in the landscape. And it's also compounded by this sort of toxicity of Washington. It's really bad to be in Washington if you're back in Tennessee or Kentucky or Montana or even California, probably. Washington is a bad place, and therefore you preserve your political purity by not fraternizing with the other side. And that is a bad thing for this sort of politics.
But I think that also Republicans are aware that, you know, Congress's approval ratings are dismal, or they were, you know, the last Congress. And so they understand that they need to think about how they're going to try to reclaim the White House in 2016 if they want a Republican president. And I think Jeb Bush put his finger on it, actually, when he said that a successful GOP candidate will have to run the nomination in such a way that he is constantly trying to strike a middle ground at the risk of losing the nomination, but that will enable him to win the White House. And that sounds like his strategy.
But also, as Mitt Romney proved, there simply aren't enough white blokes around to elect a Republican president anymore. You know,
you need women,
you need Hispanics. You know,
that's why you need the middle ground.
Okay,
can I just put a little bit of optimism, because I'm depressed. I'll give you two, and I will heavily caveat what I'm about to say, because I am slightly depressed about the state of the American system. But I'll give you two caveats. One of those is there are actually some congressmen who do go for drinks with people on the other side.
Not a lot of them.
They may not do it publicly. They may not want to be seen to be doing it, but they do it. Mm. So that's one caveat. They do still, it does still happen. The second caveat is if the federal government doesn't work, if Washington doesn't work, and I think it was Kim who said that earlier, the states will, or Michael, I can't remember. The states are taking back power. The cities are taking back power, and they're getting stuff done. Industry is taking back power because we couldn't get any environmental regulation that created a level playing field. Industry started to do it and say, we need predictability. So we're going to actually come together, the auto industry, and set up a system of rules so that we know what the world looks like in 5 years, right, because government can't do it. So other people are actually taking that. Is it be that way? Would it not be cleaner if we were all of those things? But again, I think.
But as a result,
I get nervous when people think. I think it's extraordinarily dangerous to count America out. Somebody agrees with me. I really do.
I agree.
America can actually act when it wants to act, and it may not be in a traditional way, but it can.
Okay, question.
Yeah, I was basically harkening back to the point about perception and reality, and also following on from the drone point. It was more to do with, is there a different type of war that's being fought, sometimes referred to as maybe a dirty war, where, you know, the perception that Obama is withdrawing military forces, but at the same time, JSOC has increased, you know, in fivefold in the last 10 years, as well as, you know, is deployed in more than 100 countries worldwide. So is there a different type of war, and what will it mean for Obama's legacy in 10 years' time?
war is changing all the time. I mean, absolutely. You know, we're not today, we're fighting states, but we're fighting non-state actors. That wasn't something we really worried about 20 years ago to the same degree as we do today. Non-state actors and states, for that matter, have a whole different set of tools available to them. I mean, you know, let's look at China. Or let's look at Russia. Russia, when it started its conflict against Georgia, when it started its conflict against Ukraine, it started it with a cyber war rather than boots on the ground. China has been engaging in economic warfare with a number of its neighbors, most notably Japan, on and off for the last 5 years. And natural resource warfare. So absolutely. And then let's talk about terrorists. Again, completely different type of warfare for which we need different tools. And that gets to the point of we can sit here and we can talk about should we be spending more on the military. I mean, the biggest concern I have today is sequestration. So you've got sequestration going on in the United States, which is cutting $1 trillion, is that right, over the next decade from American defense. If you talk to American military officers, they will tell you that they can make those cuts and still maintain sufficient security, keep risk relatively low. If, big if, they get to choose where to make those cuts. Today, they're not allowed to choose because Congress is choosing for them. Congress is saying, no, you can't shut that base in my district because I need the jobs.
JSOG reports directly to the president anyway, so that's
It's a different issue, though, isn't it? This is about,
But I mean, to your point, different challenges, different tools. And we need the full panoply of tools. And right now, we're kind of being limited.
Okay, next question. Lady there with the glasses.
Thank you. Some of you have mentioned the economy is a factor of Obama's legacy. However, the New Yorkers reporter George Packer wrote in The Unwinding that America has become a country of winners and losers, and that all this real estate bubble, the financial crisis, the collapse of the industry, low wages have led towards a disappointment, a national disappointment that Americans don't believe anymore in the American dream. So how do you think these real people behind the big deadlines, as he mentioned,
the American dream? Okay.
Yes. So how do you think these real people will remember Obama in this sense?
Okay, Michael.
Again, I think this is a problem of perception when you're in Washington, which is now one of the richest cities in America. The two richest counties in America, the suburban county in Maryland, Montgomery County, and the one just across the river in Arlington, because all of this money has come into Washington. And people who get there, who have the ambition to try and make a career there, will see things one way. I think that it's very clear that the economy has not reached out in an even spread away from, you know, these pockets of extreme wealth, whether, you know, from Cambridge, Massachusetts, New York City, Washington, D.C., the Bay Area, Silicon Valley, and down into Los Angeles and San Diego. And what I worry about, and we haven't discussed this, and when you asked that first question, Matt, I thought, how can you say what the legacy is when, since the deregulation of financial markets in the U.S. and the U.K. in the mid to late 80s, in the Reagan-Thatcher confluence, you know, about every 7 to 9 years, there's a crash. Mm-hmm. It's built into the system. This is what was happening, by the way, in the 1870s, in the beginnings of the first Gilded Age. Every 5, 6, 7 years, there'd be a bubble. Somebody was trying to build a railroad. All the capital would go in, and the railroad wouldn't happen, and everybody lost their money. And the ordinary people who had nothing to do with the speculation lost everything and had to struggle all over again. And what I worry about is that 2007, 2008 was the last crash. So it's not out of the realms of possibility that before he leaves office in 2016, there'll be another shock to the financial system. Mm-hmm. And this is where you'll find, to answer your question, to bring it back to you, is like, I joke about this. I say, you know, I survived the last one. I've got this pinky on the life raft. But if there's another one in the next 2 or 3 years, I'm done because, you know, I'm past the point where I have a regular job or whatever, and I have other ways of earning my living. But if it stops, all those people in the middle of the country who are just beginning to feel a little more secure,
Without security, it's another reason, America can't function without a general sense of security and stability. It will be done.
But I mean, the question was about also about the American dream. Something that, that struck me last year when I did a documentary series about the Midwest was how incredibly enduring the concept of the American dream is when all the stats, you know, I'm telling you as the dreamer that the dream is a nightmare or it doesn't exist.
I just give you one fact.
And I find that actually quite impressive, I have to say, as a non-dreamer.
You say that. 2000, I think it was 2012, may have been 2011, I think it was 2012, was the first time when Americans were polled, they believed, a majority believed, that their children would be worse off than they did. Mm-hmm. It was also the year that a majority believed that the Chinese GDP was bigger than the American GDP.
Yeah.
So,
My question is this to every one of you. I mean, the concept of the American dream. There's, you know, no one else dreams. You know, if you, the Germans don't talk about
a dream.
For obvious reasons, when the French talk about a dream, they're talking about something different.
Dream. Come on,
Michael Howard tried the British dream. No, we don't want the Chinese dream.
I don't.
But only Americans are allowed to dream.
Is the
American dream still a viable concept? Yes or no?
Depends where you're living.
Well, certainly the American dream sits at the center of American society. It is baked into our vision of who we are, and it has been for decades, probably the better part of a century. Mm. You know, ever since Horace Greeley said, "Go west, young man," everyone had this idea that, you know, there's something else out there that's going to get better. You talk about the Midwest. That's where I come from. Mm. I come from Southwest Ohio and grew up in the 70s, and during that period of time, basically what I witnessed was one industry after another, one company after another, shutting down, pulling out, relocating, job numbers going down, population going down, the economic tide rolling out. That was a terrible experience. People I went to school with, more than half of them have left the state, and the ones who remain are doing worse than I remember their parents doing, with only one or two exceptions. And yet even the people who stayed, and who, from my outside perspective looking in, are not doing as well as their parents are doing, still have a very passionate belief in what you refer to as the American dream.
And how do you explain that?
It is an expectation of what America is and how we perceive ourselves, almost in the same way that, you know, people talked about what it meant to be a Roman citizen and how it was to be, you know, to be on top of the world at a particular time. I don't think that that perception of the dream matches the reality for everyone in the U.S. Now, if my story were someone coming from Southern California or from Texas or from Manhattan, I'd probably be telling a very different story today. Certainly, the state of Georgia has gone through a huge economic renaissance, which has allowed people to move up. But America is a place of extremes, and so it's difficult to generalize.
Let me rephrase the question like this: do you think that the concept of American exceptionalism, and I would contend that the American dream is part of that exceptionalist self-view, is a blessing or a curse?
I'm not going to answer that question yet.
Why not?
Well, because I actually
you have to
I want,
answer
okay,
my
I will,
questions.
But I want to
you
actually
have
talk,
to. Yeah.
You asked about inequality. I mean, and I agree with Michael. Inequality is hugely important. I would put inequality of opportunity as being more important.
Right.
And this gets to the point of the American dream.
Okay.
If you believe you have the same opportunities available to you, that actually is what the American dream is about. And I always find it fascinating that if you pull a random sample, over 50% think that they're above average. And as long as over 50% of people think that they're above average, then you can almost kind of take that one step further and say, if you think you're above average, then you think if the opportunities come your way, you're likely to get ahead. That's the American dream.
Yeah.
American exceptionalism is a whole different kettle of fish.
But it is and it isn't. I mean, the American, you know, the self-belief through the dream is part of a, you know, is a unique
American
concept.
Exceptionalism, and this is going to be controversial, particularly of some of the Americans. I think American exception is kind of got into the same space that talking about the US-UK relationship being an, you know, kind of essential relationship. Mm. It's now rhetoric. Okay. I mean, we've got to get beyond this stuff, but we can't.
Okay, American dream, dead or alive, Michael.
Well, it depends on who you are, I suppose. I think that the secret of it, and it's interesting, the American dream was alive, really alive, as I think you mean it, Matt. Then the idea that a black guy could become president, you know, in my lifetime.
No, I mean it.
I think that the glue that holds America together is this idea
And Jorge Luis Borges wrote this brilliant story called The Lottery of Babylon. And if you want to understand the hook of it, The Lottery of Babylon, the first paragraph, is about sometimes I win and sometimes I lose, sometimes I have power over this person, sometimes this person has power over me. We are all part of a secret society. And I think that, in essence, the Americans still honestly believe, and they have daily examples of this. This is the point that British skeptics will not understand, is that everybody, you know, no matter how bitter your disappointments are, you can think of a member of your family, a friend from high school, whatever, who actually put his mind to something and was able to achieve it. And you think, if they could, I could. And this is part of the American dream. And I still think that goes on. It's just that the inequality question, and I think this is why Piketty's work is so important, is that it's finally said, you know what? There's such a concentration now. So many opportunities
it's not a level
are
playing
shut.
Field. No.
All these opportunities are shut off. I mean, some of you may be, there's quite a young crowd here, some of you may have, you know, worked as unpaid interns. Some of you may have been unable to take a good internship because you actually needed money. And I think that all of these things are now happening across the society, and it's beginning to make people question it. That said, you know, if you have a cousin who said, you know, he somehow got this money and he started a dealership and he's made it.
But
it will make you think you can do it too.
But as someone who's been marinated in European skepticism far too long, Michael, would you go up to a dreamer in Iowa who's lost his job, and or maybe he's working two jobs but he can't afford healthcare? You know, the classic American.
What, and hand him the communist manifesto?
Would you slap him around the face and say, or her, and say, listen, wake up, this is nonsense. You know, it's not a level playing field. Stop dreaming.
Well, you know, because I'm a broadcast journalist, I'll do anything to get good take. And if he wants to hit me, then that's fine.
Okay. How many? Okay, I just have one quick question again to the audience, and then stop it. No, stop.
Come on, it's your turn.
Okay, so how many people here? I don't know whether how many of you are Brits or non-Brits. How many people here think it's a good idea if Britain had a British dream, whatever that might be? Okay, hands up. Who thinks Britain should have a British dream?
Yes.
Okay. There's seven of you. Change everything. Okay.
You're missing a point in that.
Don't tell me I'm missing a point.
Well, I have to.
Okay.
I think one of the major differential things, and you can tell by this broad New York accent, except I've been here 34 years.
Yeah.
I've been here 34 years, irrespective of this broad New York accent. One of the first things that struck me when I moved here is I had very little kiddies. And if they raised their hand in class and made a mistake, they would raise their hand again and try again. Americans aren't afraid to fall on their knees, get up and say, I blew it or I made a mistake, and start all over. Where I find, you know, and I can speak with a little authority because I've spent most of my world in this country, is that it's a little shameful to admit that you have failed. And Americans are not afraid to fail.
I agree with that 100%. I think life in America is a road trip. You know, and it means that it doesn't matter if you failed, you can try again. I think England is much less forgiving. And that old cliche about there's no such thing as a second chance in America, it's just not true. Actually, there are lots of second chances.
I think it's the thing that's destroying this country.
Good point, Kim. Thank you.
You know, I did not grow up in the West. I grew up in Beirut.
Right.
So most of my friends are, you know, from the Arab world. Lots of friends in Pakistan. And for them, the American dream is still there.
It's
it
real.
Is still something that they aspire to, because of it depends where you're growing up, it depends what your circumstances are. Yes, there is a lot of inequality in the US, there are a lot of problems, but given the chance to emigrate to the US, everybody would be lining up at the embassy.
Okay, question, lady at the back.
Yeah, thanks. It's just about how Obama has been seen by other world leaders and about the international image of US, and in his desire to sort of refashion America as slightly less aggressive. Has he won more respect for the US or lost respect for the US?
You know this. You're constantly talking to people in other parts of the world.
I think it started out quite well. The president, his secretary of state, his secretary of defense in the first term did a good job recalibrating, rebalancing American power, changing the tone. You know, in the end, there weren't that many drastic changes in policy. American national security interests remain roughly the same, but it was a different approach, the idea that you know, the exercise of American power could be done with a more multilateral approach, bringing in partners. You know, the way the U.S. Went to Libya with the military action, with the British and the French and the Arabs. I know the aftermath was, you know, something, a different story to be discussed, but that was the idea behind the way Clinton and Obama and Gates approach the exercise of American power. In the second term, I think it's a very different picture. I think what you get from world leaders today is that there is a failure of leadership and that Obama's missing in action. And most of that has to do with Syria. Wrongly or rightly, the president chose a certain course of action, and it's caused a lot of anger in the Arab world. And whether it's on Russia, everything becomes sort of mangled in that he's just not willing to engage, and he gets a lot of criticism for it.
Is that fair?
I think the only thing I would add to that is he's in a fundamental dilemma. Everybody wants American leadership. Everybody wants America to use its resources to keep sea lanes open, to keep Middle East energy flowing, to keep the Chinese in their box, to keep Europe safe through NATO.
They want it all until they don't want too much of it.
And the trouble is, they also only want it when it's done their way.
Yeah.
Exactly. You know, at certain times. And and the French want something slightly different from the Brits. That want something slightly different from the Germans. Before we even get into the Japanese, the South Koreans, etc., etc. And so you just can't actually win. I mean, he cannot win.
But if he kind of said, listen, you know what? You know, forget about getting to the golf course. America's just not going to show up anymore. We're so upset by people attacking us. We're just going to, you know,
even American
down
adversaries
the hatches.
Would hate it.
Right, that's what I was going to say.
Yes,
the world would actually be quivering.
They would absolutely hate it. The Chinese love the fact that America keeps the sea lanes from the Middle East to Asia safe. Absolutely love it. They don't need to do it.
Okay, next question. Lady over there with the blonde hair. Hang on.
One thing that you sort of neglected in when looking at Syria is the fact that intervention is incredibly unpopular among the American public. If you look at polls, no one wants to go into Syria. President Obama's the fact is, President Obama's anti-intervention policy has been very popular. And I want to figure out, how do you square that circle?
Well, that's
his foreign policy has been very popular.
Does it poll popular, or do people
it
not pay?
It polls popular. Well,
does it poll?
Intervention polls, non-intervention is very popular.
It's one of those things where, just to bring it to the political level, I mean, John McCain is always for bombing these things, and he couldn't bring the Republican Party with him. And in 1994, when the Bosnian War was really dreadful, and after the Republicans had swept back to power, Bob Dole told Bill Clinton, I can bring my party, and we have to bomb these bastards off the hills of Sarajevo. And that's what happened. And that doesn't exist anymore. I think one thing that I would say, when we talk about American power, when we talk about American leadership, and this comes back to Syria, is that my experience reporting out of the Middle East was that often what is happening in Washington is actually not what's shaping the movements that are bursting forth in this terrible violence. Yeah, I mean, Iraq being an exception. But I mean, what happens in Yemen? What's happened in Syria? What's happened with this, as I say, this extraordinary bursting out of a real civil war within Islam? And it's a tripartite one, because it's within the Sunni branch of Islam. And then it's also against Shia in parts of the Middle East. Whatever we do, they don't see the world that way. They make their own decisions. They have their own worldview.
Let me ask you one question, though. Do you think the Middle East would be where it is now if Iraq had not been invaded by the coalition of the willing?
That's a very good question, Matt. And as someone, you know, said, you know, I thought, well, I believed in humanitarian intervention up to the moment I saw what the occupation looked like. Mm. And I was there for the overthrow of Saddam. You have to think that all systems run down. Saddam would have fallen sooner or later.
Right.
And it would have been chaos
sooner or later, it just was accelerated and with an accelerant of American troops.
On the question of Obama's, you know,
pop. What about drones? Do you not think the way to grow, that drone warfare is developing? Is America being the most
competitive power in that area? Will be in the position to dominate the world in due course. If you think of Syria and Iraq, and you have properly developed drones, mm. happen.
Ah, okay. Thank you. Drones, if more
I,
drones.
I mean, America dominates. It's such a, you know, terrible subject, I think, drones. I mean, on so many levels, you know, moral, legal, everything, I just... You know, where do you begin? But from a policy level, I think I agree with Zinya. You know, it can't be the arsenal. No. It is one solution from the point of policymakers, but it can't be the answer to everything. But on the point of Obama's non-interventionist policies, I agree with you. Americans are fed up with war. They don't want their troops to serve abroad anymore. The war in Iraq and in Afghanistan was very costly, both with blood and treasure. But that's not what was requested from the U.S. That's not what countries like Turkey and Saudi Arabia were asking for. They were not asking for full-on intervention. And
Americans see it as a thin end of the wedge. A lot of people see the first start bombing and then, you know, sanctions.
Well, you know, but in Libya, it didn't require troops on the ground. And we can have a discussion about what went wrong with the aftermath of the intervention. But before the Libya military intervention, the American public was against, until President Obama took to the stand and explained to them what was going to happen and why. And then they were for. So it's also about about the president's leadership and his willingness to sell something to his public and take the voters with him.
Okay, we actually don't have that much time left. Is that right? I think we've got two more questions, and we've got our lucky questioners. First of all, over there. Thank you.
Thank you. My question is, Obama's still fairly young. What kind of former president is he going to be?
What's he going to do?
Well, you've already told us. He's going on the PGA tour.
Yeah.
Seniors tour.
We're going to see Tiger Woods v. President Obama.
Exactly.
I think that's a really good question. I think he will write, and I think he'll teach. Yeah. And if there's ever a Democratic Congress again, with a Democratic president, and a vacancy turns up on the Supreme Court, it wouldn't surprise me. He could never get confirmed now, but in 2025, why not?
Possible.
Why not?
Okay, final question.
Do you think that an Iran deal will be part of Obama's legacy?
Zainia.
I was talking to somebody Monday about this, who said, and I think I agree with them, who said 6 months ago, probably would have said no. Today, it's 50-50. I mean, it's incredibly important to Iran, to the Iranians. It's incredibly important to the United States and to the West more broadly. If you can, this is the big thing, if you can get a fair deal, the problem is really not going to be so much, I think, getting the negotiation of the foreign ministers, who is now at the Kerry-Lavrov level. So, I mean, not Lavrov, excuse me.
Zarif
level. So it's kind of been elevated. The issue isn't going to be whether they can come up to a deal. The issue is going to be whether they can sell it to their capitals. Because, Michael was saying, I mean, you've already heard what Congress's response to it is. And if anything, I think that they're going to have more trouble in Iran selling it than they are even in the United States. So I think that's going to be the real problem.
Quick.
I just want to go back to the comment, because I don't want to make it sound like I'm advocating for anything, certainly not military intervention. What I am trying to say is that when the U.S., when a president decides to take his hands off a problem, there are consequences. And no one is saying that it should have been a full-on military intervention, or that, you know, I'm not saying, you know, arming the rebels would have been the right thing. I'm just saying that there was a vacuum. There was a lack of American leadership on the Syria problem. And when America is not there, just to demonstrate the point we were making, that it is still an essential leader on the global stage, other countries come in, do whatever they want. The Turks, the Saudis, the Emiratis, everybody's got involved, and you get a mess. And that's unfortunately where we are today with Syria.
Okay, no more time for questions. I'm going to ask you one final question to the audience. So we're now in 2016. It's the heat of the battle. It's Hillary Clinton versus Jeb Bush. Hillary wins, hands up. Okay. No, I would disagree with that. Now, I want to hear what you say. Hillary versus Jeb.
It's too depressing.
It's the reality. It's going to happen.
But, I mean, look, I still say that there's some black swans out there.
Yeah.
I mean, a year ago, you were in Kiev at this time. You were freezing. Did you know that? Did anyone in 2012 predict that this would happen and that we'd be facing a Russian invasion of a European country? There's so much out there in this unsettled world that's a black swan event. I think that the one thing we can be confident is it's likely to be Clinton and Bush. What we can't be confident about are the conditions in which they'll face off against each other.
Okay. Because I haven't heard from Rob for about 10 minutes. So, Rob, and that's my fault.
I'm doing fine down here.
No.
It's okay. You guys are doing great.
Hey, come on.
You're hitting these questions out of the park. I'm just saying, you go for it.
Okay, so Hillary Clinton, she wants you to do her bidding, as a good Democrat and a Democratic candidate versus Jeb Bush. Who wins?
Assuming that that's the matchup, because I have to give that caveat, because of course our party hasn't yet selected its candidate, and Mrs. Clinton hasn't even announced that she wants to run. So if she announces, and if she's selected, and if Bush is on the other side, all of those caveats. I think, knowing what we know now, I think it would be Hillary Clinton. I think it's going to depend very significantly on what might change between now and then. As we've already heard, and the so-called black swan events could tip the balance in some way, but I'm not saying it'll be sort of like a runaway, sort of like 75% of the vote goes in one direction. I think it will do what a lot of presidential elections have done in the modern age, which is the popular vote will be relatively close. The Electoral College, however, I think will be pretty significant, in part because of demographic changes in terms of where people have moved to and which states are moving into which column.
Zainia. The Hispanic vote.
So I would
Jeb
say
Bush is married to a.
I would say with all of the if the election were tomorrow.
Yeah.
So the environment is as it is today, because I agree with everybody. You just can't predict. This is way too soon to predict.
Right.
If the election were tomorrow, and it's Hillary versus Jeb Bush, I would say that Jeb Bush will win it. And to your earlier question as to
win the election.
We'll have a Bush presidency, and the reason why explains why I think it's 80-20. As to whether Hillary will run or not, because I think she's probably done a not so dissimilar calculation, which is it's really hard after 8 years of one party to actually get elected in the same party. It's really, really hard. And the names counter one another out, so you don't have any kind of pro or con on that. And you asked,
So my question wasn't quite as dumb as the show of hands would indicate.
It's, Jeb Bush is very likely to get the Hispanic vote. The Hispanic vote should be more Republican than it is Democrat.
And actually, his big brother understood that. The party didn't believe it. No.
Yeah, and he's saying all the right things. So actually, if I were to put them up against one another, I think tomorrow we would have a Bush president.
Recount.
Okay. All right. I want to thank our wonderful panel.
That's such a wussy answer.
I want to thank our wonderful panel. We're not going to talk recounts now. And you've been a great audience. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Matt.
Okay.
Thank you, Matt. Fun.